Another special case for the reflection of normal incidence is the reflection of normal incidence due to perfect electric conductor. So, assuming that region 1 is a dielectric media and region 2 is a perfect electric conductor. So, what will be the case for the reflection and transmission coefficients in this case? For the case of perfect electric conductor, the conductivity of the medium tends to be infinity. So, in this case, the intrinsic impedance of medium 2 would be the square root of j omega mu 2 over sigma 2 plus j omega epsilon 2 dash. And because sigma 2 tends to infinity, the intrinsic impedance in this case tends to be zero. So, in this case, the reflection coefficient would be gamma would be 0 minus eta 1 over 0 plus eta 1. So, it would be minus 1. The magnitude of the reflection coefficient would be 1 and the phase would be positive. And in this case, the transmission coefficient tau would be 1 minus 1 would be 0. Means that there is no transmitted field in this case inside the perfect electric conductor. So, in the case of the perfect electric conductor, the reflection coefficient gamma equals minus 1 and the transmission coefficient equals 0. So, the transmitted electric field EX20 plus would be 0 because it is tau multiplied by the incident field, so tau equals 0, and the reflected electric field or the amplitude of the electric field EX10 minus would be gamma multiplied by the incident field, so it would be minus EX10 plus. So, in this case, the total field in the transmitted region or in region 2 would be 0. The total field in region 1 would be the incident plus the reflected. So, according to the value of gamma equal minus 1, the total field in region 1 would equal the amplitude of the incident field multiplied by the forward propagation constant e to the power minus j beta 1z plus the amplitude of the reflected field, which equals minus the amplitude of the incident field multiplied by the backward propagation constant e to the power j beta 1z. And because the amplitude here are the same, we can take the amplitude as a common factor. So, the total field in this case would be e to the power minus j beta 1z minus e to the power j beta 1z multiplied by EX10 plus. The items in the packet can be simplified as minus 2j sine beta 1z. And here we have the amplitude. This is the phasor form of the total field in region 1. To obtain the instantaneous time field, we multiply this phasor component by e to the power g omega t and obtain the real value of this component. So, the instantaneous field in region 1, in this case, would be real of minus 2j sine beta 1z EX10 plus multiplied by e to the power j omega t. By taking the real value of this complex value, we find that the instantaneous electric field in this case, it would be 2 Ex 10 plus sine beta 1 z sine omega t. Effectively, the time dependence here is sine omega t, not cosine omega t. Why? Because effectively we have j here, minus j. So minus j multiplied by e to the power j omega t. E to the power j omega t is cosine omega t plus j sine omega t. So if we multiply e to the power j omega t by minus j, so it would be minus j cosine omega t minus j multiplied by j, so it is plus 1 sine omega t. So it would be minus j cosine omega t plus sine omega t. By taking the real value, it would be sine omega t. Okay? So the instantaneous electric field in this case would be double the amplitude of the incident field multiplied by sine beta 1 z multiplied by sine omega t. In a similar way, we can obtain the total magnetic field in region 1. Before going to the total magnetic field in region 1, we remember that the total magnetic field in region 2 is also 0. Okay? Now, the total magnetic field in region 1, it would be the magnetic field of the incident field plus the magnetic field of the reflected field. And the magnetic field of the incident field, it can be obtained as the magnitude of the incident electric field over the intrinsic impedance of medium 1, and the magnetic field of the reflected field equals minus the amplitude of the reflected electric field over the intrinsic impedance of medium 1. So in this case, the reflected electric field equal gamma multiplied by the incident electric field, and gamma is minus 1. So minus 1 multiplied by minus 1 would be positive 1. So in this case, the total magnetic field in region 1 would be the amplitude of the incident electric field Ex10 plus over the intrinsic impedance of medium 1 eta 1 multiplied by the forward propagation constant e to the power minus g beta 1 z plus the backward propagation constant e to the power g beta 1 z. Should be noted that in this case, this plus sign is effectively minus minus. Alright? Once again, to obtain the instantaneous magnetic field, we are going to multiply this by e to the power j omega t and take the real value of this value. So, in this case, the items in the bracket can be replaced by 2 multiplied by cosine beta 1 z. And to obtain the real value in this case, this would be cosine omega t. So, the instantaneous magnetic field in this case is 2 Ex10 plus the amplitude of the incident electric field over eta 1, the intrinsic impedance of medium 1, multiplied by cosine beta 1 z. This 2 cosine beta 1 z is the item in this bracket. Cosine omega t is the real value of the exponential term. If you remember, the instantaneous electric field, it was 2 Ex10 plus sine beta 1 z sine omega t. So, in this case, there is a phase shift in time domain between the electric field and magnetic field equal pi over 2, because this is sine and this is cosine. So there's a phase shift 90 degrees in time between the electric field and magnetic field. Also, the electric field in this case in the space is proportional to sine beta 1z, while the magnetic field in the space is proportional to cosine beta 1z. So the peaks or the locations of the peak of the magnetic field are the location of the peak of the cosine, but the location of the peak of the electric field are the location of the sine, and effectively the location of the peak in the sine are the location of the minimum or the nulls of the cosine. So effectively the peaks of the electric field lies at the location of the nulls of the magnetic field, and vice versa, the location of the peaks of the magnetic field lies at the location of the nulls of the electric field. Now, we obtain the electric field and magnetic field in instantaneous form in this form. Should be noted that these functions represent what we are calling standing wave function. In standing wave function, we find the spatial dependence or z dependence and the time dependence are not in the same function, but they are two separate functions multiplied by each other. To remember, for the case of propagating wave, in the case of forward propagating wave, the electric field, it was the amplitude multiplied by cosine omega t minus beta 1z. Here the argument of the function includes both time and space. So this can be simplified as omega multiplied by t minus z over vb1, or the phase velocity of medium 1. So this t, the argument of the function, is t minus z over velocity. This is the property of the wave function. The property of the wave function is that the argument includes both time and space. But here, the argument of the space is presented in a function, and the argument of time is presented in another function, and these two functions are multiplied by each other. So this is not propagating wave. But in this case, the electric field is time varying with time separately, and also it is varying with space. And in this case, we can find that this sine has peaks at certain points where the value of the sine is 1, and has nulls when the sine is 0. And these peaks and nulls depends only on the space. So they are presenting peaks minimum in the space, which are fixed in the space. So they are not moving with time. So we are calling this standing wave vector. Similarly, cosine beta 1z, cosine omega t represent another standing wave vector. And as we mentioned, the difference between sine beta 1z and cosine beta 1z is the location of the peaks here correspond to the location of the nulls here, and vice versa. So that's what we are seeing. This representation of the total field in region 1, we recognize this total field in region 1 as a standing wave obtained by combining two waves of equal amplitude traveling in opposite direction. So effectively, any traveling wave forward and backward traveling in opposite direction, the summation of them introduce what we are calling the standing wave. The factor involving time and distance are separate in trigonometric terms. here in standing wave, we find that the function of the distance is separated from the function of the time. As we remember, in traveling wave, here we see the term omega t minus beta z, which characterize wave traveling in positive z direction in the velocity. So, in the case of traveling wave, the argument includes both time and the space inside the same function. So, in conclusion, the total field in region 1 in this case is represented by standing wave, not traveling wave. And this standing wave for the electric field is represented as sine beta 1 z sine omega t. And effectively, this standing wave has nulls when the value of sine beta 1 z equals 0. So, at each location where beta 1 z satisfy 0 by 2 by 3 by n by, so in at each region this would be the total electric field would be 0. So in this case there will be special nulls in the standing wave pattern of the electric field, and this nulls occurs when beta 1 z is m by, where m is integer value and starting from 0. So, in this case, beta is 2 by over lambda 1. Beta is a propagation constant, can be represented in terms of the wavelength as 2 by over lambda 1. So, beta z equal m by at the nulls. Or, in other words, the locations of the nulls are m lambda 1 over 2 by taking this lambda in this side and by netted by by, so it is m lambda 1 over 2. So at each half wavelength we can find a null. So we have a null exactly at the interface. Effectively, this null physically comes from the amplitude of the incident field and the amplitude of the reflected field are the same and opposite side. So we have a null at the interface. And we have another null after lambda by 2. We have another null after lambda. We have another null after 3 lambda over 2 and so on. So in this case, for example, if we have a receiver and we are located at a distance lambda by 2 from a perfect electric conductor, we will not receive anything. Why? Because we are standing in the null. So the electric field in this case is always 0. So the antenna after lambda by 2 will not receive any signal if the antenna is characterized by the electric field. Okay? So the electric field Ex equals 0 at the boundary at z equals 0 and at every half wavelength from the boundary in region 1. If we want to draw the standing wave pattern in this case, we find that the electric field looks like a sinusoidal, standing sinusoidal wave, and this standing sinusoidal wave is always 0 at z equal lambda over 2, z equal lambda, z equal 3 lambda, and so on. And effectively, the electric field in this case is still function of sine omega t. So this function is time varying in omega t. So according to sine omega t, it can be negative or positive. So it is varying in time, but it is always 0 here. And here it is varying in time, but it is always 0 here, and so on. In a similar way, the magnetic field has another standing wave pattern. But in this case, the peak of the magnetic field start at z equals 0, because it is cosine beta 1 z. So at z equals 0, the cosine is 1 or big. Then, after lambda by 4, we have the first null. Then, we move to be 3 lambda over 4 to find out the second null, and so on. So, effectively, the magnetic field is represented by another standing wave pattern, but the nulls in this case are shifted by lambda by 4 from the nulls of the electric field. So, the location where the electric field is maximum correspond to the location of the null of the electric field. And the location of the null of the electric field corresponds to the location of the maximum of the magnetic field. So, we say that special nulls in the standing wave pattern of the electric field occur at all times when beta 1 z equal m by. But the magnetic field is also standing wave pattern, but it shows maximum amplitude at the position where the electric field is zero. So, if the electric field is zero, the magnetic field is maximum. It can also be noted that the magnetic field has a phase shift 90 degrees between the electric field, because the magnetic field here depends on cosine omega t, and the electric field depends on sine omega t. So, magnetic field is also 90 degrees out of phase with the electric field everywhere. If we remember, when we studied the Poynting vector, we said that the Poynting vector is half the value of the electric field across the magnetic field conjugate. And we said that this result is half the amplitude of the electric field multiplied by the amplitude of the magnetic field multiplied by cosine the phase between the electric and the magnetic field. And because the phase between the electric and the magnetic field in this case is 90 degrees, so cosine the angle between them would be zero. So in this case, because the phase shift of the 90 degrees, as a result, the average power as determined through the Poynting vector is zero in the forward and backward direction in this case. And physically, what happens? Effectively, the incident power is completely reflected power. So, the total power at any point is 1 minus the amplitude of the reflection coefficient squared. And the amplitude of the reflection coefficient is 1. So, 1 minus 1 squared is 0. So, the total power at any point in region 1 is 0, because the incident equals the reflected and they are in opposite directions. Okay? Alright. So, we finished the special case of perfect conductor.